Okay, so as Sydney just said, my name is Vincent. I'm working at Topicus Healthcare, and I will tell a bit this evening about implementing AWS at Topicus Healthcare. So I have one slide prepared about Topicus, and then I will dive into what we actually did. So Topicus Healthcare is part of the larger Topicus family, and we have about 1,000 employees, and I work for the healthcare division. And the healthcare division has about 200 employees, and we make software for different customers in the healthcare industry. So for examples, general practitioners or hospitals. One of the coolest products, personally, I think, is that we have software that makes sure that ambulances are getting in the right direction when someone is in need. So we like to say Topicus makes impact on the Netherlands, and I actually first I thought it was a bit of a marketing slogan, but when I saw the numbers about what we did, I really think we are making an impact with this kind of products. If you would like to know more about Topicus, just talk to me after the presentation. So what was our starting point before we went to AWS? So we had two large VMware clusters running in our on-premise data centers. We had our traditional operations team, which was a fully self-servicing, self-functioning operations team, which consisted of about 6 people. They managed about 35 applications. As you can imagine, when you manage 35 different applications for different customers with 6 people, that's not always going very well. So what actually happened was that 1 or 2 times a week, someone would get called out of bed to fix those applications. And to make things worse, there was almost no configuration management. So after a few years of having this structure going on, there was a lot of frustration with our development teams and with our operations teams. So it was your classical siloed operations setup. Software was thrown over the fence to the operations team, and they had to deal with everything. They were responsible for the networking infrastructure, for the dedicated servers underlying the VMware instances. They were responsible for the VMs and also for the applications. So as you can imagine, they had a lot of work, and it didn't go very well. So we had to rethink that philosophy, and we also made the choice to go to the public cloud. So what did we do? So first of all, we acknowledged that we didn't have the knowledge to build on AWS ourselves, so we contacted Oblivion, and they started with this concept called the landing zone. You're probably familiar with that. And Oblivion built for us this landing zone, which consisted of IAM, VPC, and some security features. So if you're not familiar with the landing zone concept, it's make sure that every new AWS account gets a default set of resources deployed. So for example, all of our security practices are employed inside each AWS account. And for example, there is a single sign-on going on for IAM, so every employee has the right permissions. As Sydney mentioned, I started thinking about what can we do after we have the landing zone, because the landing zone is great, but it's not where we want to be in the end, because the landing zone is very basic, but I have about 20 development teams, which all need to use AWS. So what I could have done was just give permissions to each development team and say, hey, go find out yourself what AWS is and go deploy some services. We chose not to do that. So we realized there was a bit of a gap there. And as I was inspired by the landing zone concept, I had a bit of a challenge on my mind about how can we get our teams on board without knowing everything about AWS. So then I thought maybe it's good to introduce a new concept. And the concept we introduced was that This is the wrong slide. it was a concept about how we can let teams deploy services into AWS. But before I go into that, I would first like to let you see how we organize this, because technology is only one part of the story. So this image can look a bit familiar. It's actually adopted from a new book and a website called DevOps Team Topologies. If you're not familiar with it, please look it up. It's very interesting. And what we actually did, we created a new virtual platform team. So our platform team is virtual, as I said, and consists of people working in the development teams. There is a small exception. Myself, I'm not working in a development team right now. But my other team members are working as developers in our product and development teams. By building such a virtual team, we have a constant flow of information through to the development teams, to the platform team, and so on, because they are in both teams, of course. And our operations team, we see that as being AWS. So we don't have an operations team anymore currently. So of course, there's still ops needed in the as a specialty, as some what people need to know. They know a bit about ops and need to know a bit about networking, but we don't have specific ops people. Everyone works in a development team. So what are the responsibilities of this team? So as a platform team, we are cloud experts and we build a cloud toolbox. The cloud toolbox that we built, I will show you later on, and we provide best effort support. And the product team has different responsibilities. They are, first of all, product and business experts. They know what they need to build for their customers to solve their problems of their customers. They use the cloud toolbox we built as the platform team, and in most cases, they are 24/7 responsible for the product. So if a product fails in the middle of the night, a hospital just needs our software to work. So they get called out of bed. By only giving best effort support from my platform team, the product teams have to have a basic understanding about what they deploy into AWS. So they are in such a way enforced to know a bit about AWS. This is also a challenge, but currently it works very well. So with responsibilities, we have to give people permissions. And what we said is we don't want people to go into the AWS console and click in the GUI to deploy the services. So we made a very strict rule, which states that we only do mutations through infrastructure as code. They only have read-only access to the console and the command line. And by enforcing this procedure, the deployment of infrastructure is the same as building their applications. They already have a software development process. They already do pull requests. They already have QTS integration. So they are forced to use this process. Also, there is, of course, always a possibility that there's an emergency going on, so we have a break glass procedure. That break glass procedure is a specific procedure in which we use our own identity provider, which we built internally, and you can activate specific permission set after writing down why you have to elevate your permissions, and then you get access to all permissions in your AWS account. One of the things that we're doing when this procedure takes place is my platform team and the whole product team gets notified. So if someone needs to use this procedure, we as a platform team probably did something wrong because they don't have the permissions they need, or we have to improve something in our infrastructure, or maybe it's just their software, but it's not to check them, it's to improve and help each other. So as we enforce that people are using only infrastructure as code, we have to use infrastructure as code tools like Terraform or CloudFormation. We chose CloudFormation as our primary infrastructure as code solution. And we built this system based on modules and building blocks. So a module is an easier interface for a team. So in our platform team, we built these modules. And these modules are developed as a product. So we do change logs on our platform. So each team can upgrade to a new version of the platform on themselves. One of the issues we have, of course, is that since we are operating in healthcare industry, we're bound to NAN and ISO certifications, and we can just enforce such security policies in our modules. I will show an example of that later on. One thing which is important is that those modules are recommended but not required. So teams still have an option to build their own modules, just deploy and write their own CloudFormation code. We call this team modules. A team can build their own modules. Because we are bound to NAN and ISO, we actually don't see many teams build their own modules, because we rather try to improve our current modules so that it also fits their use case. And therefore, every development team has a benefit with a new version of the module. So we built 28 modules and counting, so we are gradually adding more modules. Interesting is that a module is just a specification. So a building block is an instance of a module, same as that you would have a class and an instance of a class. A module in this case is a class and a building block is an instance. What makes is that the instance different parameters. So how do we deploy these modules? So first of all, we built a pipeline. It's fully in Python, and we use the Jinja 2 templating engine, which might sound familiar if you're using Python. This is very powerful, and it gives us the possibility to use variables and if-else structures. Then we built this concept about environments. So of course, if you're deploying your application to an acceptance environment or to a production environment, you want to keep that environment similar as possible. But of course, maybe in acceptance, you don't want multi-AZ deployment of a database instance. In the production, you do want. So we built an environment concept where you can flip some parameters yourselves. We also have some validation and deployment steps. So the validation step does, for example, CloudFormation linting and Kubernetes linting. The deployment step then deploys for you to one of the supported infrastructure as code solutions. So now we support CloudFormation, Kubernetes, Lambdas, and Terraform. And a module consists of one or more of those different infrastructure as code tools. So how does it look for a development team? So this is a simple YAML file to deploy an RDS Postgres instance. As you can see, there are not a lot of configuration parameters here, only the parameters that are specific for each team. So we cannot decide which database server one of our 20 development teams needs. How large should it be? I don't know. They know the best their performance characteristics of their application. And one thing you might notice is that we have a specific archiving interval. As you are probably aware, RDS has a maximum backup retention period of 35 days. In most cases, that's not enough for us, because we are bound to some local laws that force us to keep backups for a longer time, sometimes up to 10 years. So we need something else than 35 days. And by exposing such a simple property, we have a whole process going on under the hoods, but they only have to know to tell us how many times a month do you want this archiving process to run. So what's in this module then? Of course, there's CloudFormation to deploy the RDS instance. We have a schema validator so that we can make sure that if someone specifies a value that's not valid, the build fails. Of course, we have a README. Since we developed this as a product, we want to give the team some documentation about what is the recommended setting for this property. we give them an example. And in this case, we have a custom archiving feature, which I just told you about. So I would like to head over to my editor now. So this is our AWS modules repository. And I will open the RDS Postgres module. So currently, we only have Postgres. We are probably adding SQL Server soon. As you can see, there are a few files in there. So first of all, of course, there's a README file. And this README file lists all the parameters and also what they are for. As our teams might not be familiar with the storage types AWS provides, we describe the storage type options for them. Then we have a schema file. A schema file is actually a JSON schema file which we apply to YAML, which is interesting in itself. But here we enforce teams to, for example, require some properties. And these are all properties that we can't choose for them, since we don't know about enough about their applications. Then we have, of course, an example, which is similar to the one I showed you on the slide. And then we have our CloudFormation file. As you can see, we have a lot of different resources in here. So here are some CloudFormation parameters. Then we have, let's look at the, so here's the RDS instance itself. It's not that much configuration, but we do apply the best practices we have to make sure it's compliant. And of course, there are a lot of other properties, specific database parameters we would like to override on top of the defaults AWS provides, security groups. As you can see, there are a lot of there's a lot of configuration going on. And in the end, we have about a little bit more than 500 lines of code, which is a lot more than the few lines I just showed you, for example, in this example file. So the teams don't have to think about all those different properties. We make it a bit easier for them to deploy a database server. Also, in this case, the archiving feature, for example, we have a lot of stuff going on under the hoods. Our archiving process is for teams as simple as specifying one of the allowed values, which are, in this case, every Saturday, first and 15th day of the month, or first day of the month. And what we do for them is, at that interval, make sure an ECS container is getting started. We are booting a new RDS instance. We're overruling the rules in Postgres. We then PG dumping all the tables and ship it to, after it's encrypted, to an S3 bucket in another region. And there was a lot of work to build that, but for teams it's very easy to just specify whatever fits their needs. So this is just an example of our Postgres instance. So are any people running Kubernetes on AWS themselves with AWS EKS? Yeah, I see one hand. It's probably hard, right, to update and manage everything. So this is our RDS for our EKS configuration. And we have a lot of stuff going on here to just make sure everything that's missing in EKS, we provide that for our teams. So for our teams, it's as easy as just pumping a version, and we are deploying different versions of different containers to make sure everything is working as expected. As you can imagine, this gives us some economy of scale. So when a bug is found in our modules library, we can fix it once and have benefit from it at all the development teams. So of course you're thinking, is this really working? Yes, it is. We have a lot of teams already running on this. I'm opening one of the environments of our teams. And what I would like to show you here is how they use the environment file. So These are their building blocks. And for example, in this case, they also deploy RDS or maybe an ingress or application load balancer connecting to their applications. So what do they do to make sure their environments are the same? So these are the two environment firewalls they have for acceptance and production. And we at first we just built this concept to give the team some power to just fine-tune a few parameters. But some teams were very happy with this feature and built a bit more than we expected in these environment files. It's not a very hard thing to do. It's just a simple YAML list. But they configured a lot of different properties to make sure what is getting deployed. So for example, they have a whole list here of all the Docker tags of their Docker containers that they are deploying in their cluster. So releasing for them is nothing more than just changing this commit, push it, this tag, which is a git commit, might be confusing, and push it, and then it's get rolled out. Of course, it goes to their current software development process of pull requests and automatic testing. So they can very easily release it. And probably if I switch to their production environment, they have another tag. As you can see, this team is in the process of getting more applications to AWS. They have a lot more in acceptance than in production. They are actually going to release this December with a lot of projects also, which might be interesting. One of these products is using our DigiD connection. So we are going to get audited by Logius. So it's also interesting for us to see what's going to happen there. But we're very confident we will get through. But maybe it's good to keep in touch. So another example of that would be our, let's say, for example, they have these team modules. Most of the teams use these team modules to deploy stuff in Kubernetes. So you see a lot of Kubernetes YAML files here. And this is a deployment file. And a deployment file in Kubernetes just configures how is this container deployed in my Kubernetes cluster. So one of the things that they do is they change the number of replicas depending on the environment. So in production, they deploy three containers. And in acceptance, they only deploy two containers, for example. So it's a very powerful mechanism for them to get the same environment and only change the properties they need to change. As you can imagine, we have a lot of other possibilities by using these kind of files. So one thing they do that I actually don't like is they use these if statements. So they have chosen to fully enable or disable a building block in acceptance or in versus production. So they also have these this file, which is only rolled out in production. So this is a bit of a misusage about the environment in the environment concept, but they are free to do that. They don't break any rules or give any issue with our logic. This is just a simple Jinja 2 if statement. Actually, we also built some Jinja helpers, for example, to resolve parameters from the parameter store, from the secrets manager, or even stuff that gets encrypted with the KMS. So that gives us the possibility for teams to, on their local system, for example, encrypt a private key, commit it into their Git repository, and when Jenkins executes this pipeline, it gets decrypted automatically with the key in KMS, and they can actually roll out that confidential information without encrypting it, without getting it unencrypted in their Git repository. So we have some different functions for that. Okay, so what challenges do we face? Actually, we have teams that are blindly updating. So although we do use semantic versioning with major minor patch, some teams just update. So they give us a lot of trust that we don't break anything, but actually we would like them to read the actual change logs because we put a lot of effort in it and it makes the migration process to a new version easier. Another challenge we have is the release interval. So currently we release this product every 3 to 4 weeks and we have chosen such a slow release cycle because we don't want the teams to update to the new version of the platform every sprint they have. But on the other end, we have teams helping us and improving our platform. So if they are adding a feature to this module structure, they're actually pinging us to say, hey, when do you release? When do you release? I have to use this feature. So it's a bit of a balance that we have to choose here. Not releasing too fast, not releasing too slow. Then we have a testing challenge. So actually, we do test our wall pipeline with mainly unit tests. But what we did find out actually last week, we had some issues, is that we don't have a very good integration or smoke testing environment. So what we actually would like to do is deploy our wall infrastructure, or actually all our modules every night and smoke test them. So it's great that my CloudFormation file is a valid CloudFormation file with a database in it, but if I deploy the database, can I log in with the database user that is specified? So it's a whole other kind of test, and we don't have that kind of test yet. So we would like to add that in the coming months. And the other one is that the MVP term, not to mistake with minimal viable product, is we would like to keep a minimal viable platform. So we have some kind of feature creep going on, and it makes it harder and harder with the more building blocks and modules we make for teams to keep everything lean and not too large. So one of the rules we have is that we don't build any features that only one team requests. Or if one team does request it, and we see benefit for it for other teams, but we don't build unicorn modules, for example. Well, thank you for your interest in my presentation.